Hello students, this is Dr. Ghanshyam Chauhan. Today we are going to discuss regarding new unit. So unit number 2. So in that unit number 2, we will start with another new topic, cholera. So in this unit, we will discuss regarding the general principles for prevention and control of the various types of diseases. So in that we will discuss the disease cholera. What is cholera? Cholera is an acute diarrheal illness caused by infection of the intestine with the bacteria Vibrio cholerae. So this is the bacteria which is responsible for infection of our small intestine as well as large intestine, and due to which the symptoms like diarrhea, the symptoms like vomiting, watery stools, watery feces will be developed. And also if you see the skin becomes very scanty, very dry, and lots of dehydration has been occurred in this type of conditions. So cholera is this Vibrio cholera, this bacteria is comma shaped and gram negative aerobic and facultative anaerobic bacillus that varies in size from 1 to 3 Armstrong in length and 0.5 to 0.8 Armstrong in diameter. This is its size. Its antigenic structure consists of flagellar H antigen and somatic O antigen. So there are two types of antigens are available of this antigen. Now virulence pathophysiology. Now here we will discuss how it will proliferate, how it will develop, and how it will ingest it into your body, enter into your body. So ingestion of Vibrio cholerae. So it can be transmitted by the various ways, for example by infected water, by infected food, or by infected any sort of things which we are ingesting in our body. So it can be get entered mostly from the water which has been infected with the feces, or it can be infected with the various waste materials which can be come out from the various resources. So when they are come in contact with your drinking water, so mostly it is a waterborne disease. Also if your food already has been infected with that cholera, Vibrio cholera, so when you are taking that inside your body, so ingestion occurs when you are taking that drinking water. That's why we should not drink the water from the rivers, because they are mostly infected, because the peoples are doing their defecation and that waste material, that defecation are come in contact with our drinking water. And when you are drinking that water, when you are drinking that water from the river, so at that time the bacteria will get infected to us. They are get entered into your body. So there is resistant to the gastric acid, colonize small intestine. So they will get entered into your small intestine. They are absorbed there and they are gathered there and they are increasing their numbers. They are colonized there. Virulence of a non-toxic Vibrio cholerae. One stain not well understood. Now here the secret enterotoxin is there. What is enterotoxin? Which is toxin to your small intestine. So the secret that enterotoxin there means they are releasing that enterotoxin into your small intestine, and this enterotoxin bind to the intestinal wall, means the mucosa of your small intestine, it has been affected. And they are entering into your mucosa and through that they are entering into your systemic blood circulation, and they are depositing into the mucosal layer of our small intestine, and that lamina propria and the epithelial cell are going to be damaged and they are incorporating into that cells. This is enterotoxin bind to the intestinal cells. And chloride channels are activated, and due to which the chloride channels will be activated and release large quantities of electrolytes and bicarbonates, and due to which the chloride channels will activate the lots of electrolytes, the sodium ions will be released, And you know what is the property of sodium ions? Sodium ions are released along with the large quantity of water. So due to which into our that lumen, into our intestine, lots of water and electrolyte will be released, and also bicarbonates will be released. And fluid hypersecretions means the fluid, that watery stool or that fluid into your lumen will be secrete more and more quantity. So hypersecretion will be there. After that, diarrhea will be developed, means the watery stool will be developed. And dehydration, not only the watery stool will develop, but also the vomiting like condition will be there. So the water which is inside your body, complete water will come out from your body by two ways, either by diarrhea and or by vomiting. So by emesis and by diarrhea, the water will come out from your body and your body will completely dehydrated. So complete dehydration will occur. The host factors, so that host factor, age, children, so 10x or more susceptible than adult, and elderly also higher susceptible. So at any age they are susceptible, means they are more prone to have these infections. Sex equal in both male and female, means both the sex has been affected in these conditions. Immunity less immune are high risk. Thus the people who are having very less immunity, they are at the high risk. People with low gastric acid levels, they are also at the high risk. Blood types, so in this blood type it is very interesting, the blood type of O blood group, they are more and more susceptible, they are more and more sensitive for these infections. After that, B blood group, either positive or negative, and after B blood group there is A, and finally AB, means the sequence will go from the O, B, A and AB, means O blood group, O and B are more sensitive and AB are resistant to these infections. Risk factors, poor sanitary conditions, so rare in developed countries, because in developed countries they are having very good sanitary conditions has been developed. It is very common in Asia, you know, at Asia, Africa, these countries are very poor countries, they are not having money to maintain their hygienic conditions. So that's why in these countries we are having very poor sanitary conditions. Nowadays in India the sanitary conditions are going to be somewhat normalized, but still lots of the scarcity is there. People are not going to be serious regarding their sanitary conditions. Raw or undercooked food, it is also another risk factor. So the contaminated seafoods, so when you are taking that undercooked foods, it is also one of the risk factor. Even in developed countries it may happen. That's why some people are having habit to half cook the food and eat it. It is very bad habits. So we should eat the food which is completely cooked. So we should not do that we are cooking the food half. Next is hypochlorhydria. So the people with low levels of stomach acid, such as children, older adults and some medications, so due to some medication also the hypochlorhydria will be there. What is hypochlorhydria? When we are having less quantity of HCl secretion into our gastric, so people with low stomach acid, so people are having low stomach acid, for example the people who are taking antacid from so very long period, so due to which also the less secretion of HCl will be there. Also in case of children and adults. And type of blood, so reasons aren't entirely clear, but twice more likely, means the blood group of O are more prone to have been infected with this disease. Transmission, now we will see the mode of transmission. humans only reservoirs, means from human it can be transferred from one person to the another person. Contaminated food and water. So as we know, so humans are secreting their waste material, their feces. So this their feces can be get contaminated with the food and water, either by any way. And the inadequate sewage treatments. So when we are not doing treatment to our sewage, definitely it will get introduce that infection towards us. So inadequate sewage treatments. So that's why whatever sewage is there, we should not contaminate with our drinking water. Our line should be different, or that sewage water should be processed. Lack of water treatments. So we should do the proper water treatments. So whatever the waste material is there, we should properly treat it. Improper cooked shellfish. So we should cook that shellfish properly, otherwise they will definitely produce the harm to you. People are having habit to half cook the fish, so which is not good for our health. Transmission by causal contact, unlikely. So there are also some causal contact through which the transmission may occur. Period of communicability. During acute stage, the communication can be occur a few days after recovery. After recovery also, the communication can be occur. By the end of week, 70% patients not infectious. So by the end of week, the 70% patients are not infectious, means they are not having any symptoms. By end of third week, 98% non-infectious. So this is the period of communicability. Incubation. Now if you see incubation, the range from few hours to 5 days. So it can stay in your body, it can stay into your intestine, it will stay into your liver for few hours to 5 days. Incubation period is too much. Average is 1 to 3 days, and shorter incubation period. High gastric pH. Now in case of high gastric pH, from use of antacids, so due to which the pH will become high of your gastric. It should not become high, it should be less, because the due to secretion of HCl it should become less, but due to use of intake of antacids for longer period, it will become high gastric pH, means our pH become less acidic. And consumption of high doses of cholera. So when we are doing consumption of high doses of cholera by drinking water or by infected food. Infectious dose. Water infectious dose is 10^3 to 10^6 organisms. So that much titer, that much amount of virulent, that typical bacteria when you are ingesting, so it will be infectious dose. Ingested with food, fewer organisms, 10^2 to 10^4. So by ingested food, it will be this quantity, and by water it's too much, it is 10^3 to 10^6, means mostly the water are the main sources. Infected water are main sources for having infections. Symptoms. Now you will see symptoms one by one. Usually mild or no symptoms at all. So in 75% cases it is asymptomatic, and in 20% there are mild disease, because it is totally depends on our immunity. If you are having strong immunity, you don't have any symptoms. But in case of weak immunity, the people are 2-5% in which severe condition can be developed, means they are having all the symptoms, and sometimes it will become critical also. So symptoms like vomiting is a major symptom. Person start to do vomiting, and cramps in our body, in our muscle, cramps will be developed. Profuse, painless diarrhea. The diarrhea will be very painless, and continued diarrhea will be there. And vomiting of clear fluid. Whenever you are vomiting, during vomiting, so the fluid will be very clear. And rice water. Whatever the diarrhea is there, whatever the feces, water stool is there, it will rice water like color. And 1 liter per hour or 20 ml per kg during 4 hours observation of period. So this is the typical color of the feces. As you will see, it is just look like rice water diarrhea. This is the typical symptoms of our cholera. So in cholera conditions, this is the color of feces, typical white color, white rice color. Cholera gravis, there are various types of cholera that we will discuss here. Cholera gravis, they are more severe symptoms. So it is very, very severe. This is the condition that you can see by the face. Rapid loss of body fluids, continue loss of body fluid is there. Produce 10 to 20 liters, it is too much quantity. 10 to 20 liter per day, it is a quantity, means that much water is going to be thrown outside of the body. 107 vibrios per ml. Rapidly lose more than 10% of body weight. So if you are having body weight 100 kg, immediately it will be reduced to 90 kg and so on, and daily it will be lose your weight very fastly. Dehydration and shock. So after the continual loss of water from our body by vomiting as well as by diarrhea, so it will develop into the condition like an anaphylactic shock will be there. Patient's skin turning bluish gray. So due to lack of RBC count, so the bluish color will be there, means slightly cyanosis like condition will be developed. Hue from extreme loss of fluid. So whatever that water is there, body fluid is there, going to be loose from your body. So due to which bluish gray color of skin will be there. Death within 12 hours or less. So it is very critical condition. So death of patient occurs within 12 hours or less than that. It is a cholera sicca. This cholera sicca is as older term describing a rare severe from cholera that occurs in epidemic cholera. This form of cholera is manifest as ileus and abdominal distension from massive outpouring of fluid. Means when we are having lots of vomiting occurs, so due to which the distension, means lots of pain occurs, lots of cramp is there in your abdomen, and due to which the vomiting occurs and the electrolytes into diluted intestine loops. The mortality is high with death resulting from toxemia before onset of diarrhea and vomiting. So the toxic substances are entering into your blood, it is called toxemia. So that death occurs due to continued diarrhea and vomiting, nothing is remaining into your body. The mortality in this condition is high because the unusual presentation, failure to recognize the condition as form of cholera is common. Now cholera in children. In children it is very common, and due to which lots of children are losing their life. The breastfeed infants are protected. The symptoms are severe and fever in frequent. The shocks, drowsiness and coma are common. The hypoglycemia is the recognized complication. Whatever the glucose level is there, it is going to be declined because continue vomiting and diarrhea. So whatever the glucose inside your body is going to be thrown outside. So that's why the hypoglycemia like condition will be developed, which may leads into the convulsions. So if you are losing your glucose will go outside, due to which the convulsion will be developed because the neurons are also required glucose, and if they are not getting the sufficient amount of glucose for their energy, for their functioning, for the ATP generation, so convulsion will be developed. Rotavirus infection may give similar picture and need to be excluded. So rotavirus also having the same type of symptoms. That's why rotavirus also one of the leading cause of death in kids. That's why we should give them that vaccine within 6 months. From 2 months to 6 months, this is the proper age to give the vaccine to the kids of rotavirus. Consequences of severe dehydration. Intravascular volume depletion. So our intravascular volume means our blood volume is going to be decreased due to the continued vomiting and diarrhea. Severe metabolic acidosis will be developed, means the acidity of your metabolic condition is going to be increased. Hypokalemia will develop. What is hypokalemia? When there is decreased level of potassium into your body. Why? Because when you are doing diarrhea, when you are doing vomiting at a time, what is that potassium? Potassium is the intracellular fluid. That intracellular electrolyte is going to be throw outside. It will unnecessarily, it will go outside. The loss of potassium will be there. Due to this, hypokalemic condition will be there. This potassium is required for lots of activities in your body. That's why it may lead into the cardiac arrest. And low blood sugar, the hypoglycemia will develop because our body glucose is going to be lost. Due to this, the hypoglycemia condition will be developed. And it may lead into the seizures. Twitching of muscles will be there, convulsions will be developed due to the less quantity of glucose which is required for our neuronal innervation. It is required for your firing of neurons, the impulse generation, impulse communication, impulse development, impulse communication, impulse transmission. For that we require that glucose, and if glucose is not there, it will lead into the seizures and coma, especially in the young. And cardiac and renal failure will be developed because it completely affects on our blood volume, and due to which the fluid volume is going to be affected, the volume is going to be declined, and due to which the cardiac and renal arrest, because the blood completely depends on the cardiac activity and the kidney activity. If blood volume is going to be declined, definitely it will affect on your cardiac, because our heart also require the glucose for their functions, and also our kidney require for their ATP generation, for their functioning. Sunken eyes. What is sunken eyes? The eyes are go deep into our eye orbit, and whatever the skin below the eye, that becomes completely dark, very black, and they also become inflamed. Inflammation of our skin around your eyeball occurs, so that is called sunken eyes. Means eye becomes very go deep, and they becomes very pale, and decrease skin turgor. What is skin turgor? When we are taking pinch to our skin, so it requires some time to go to its normal position. So when the skin don't go its normal position, or it requires more than 2-3 seconds to go its normal position, so that typical skin is called as skin turgor. So we lost our skin turgor, means we lost our, if we will pinch, immediately skin will go to its normal position. So in that condition, skin doesn't go its normal position, means skin becomes completely dry, it completely pale, it is a completely loss of elasticity occurs. Almost no urine productions, because how urine will produce? Because if there is no blood, blood volume has been declined, due to which almost no urine production will be there. Our complete collapse of our kidney function will occur. Diagnosis, clinical diagnosis. Cholera should be considered in all cases with severe watery diarrhea and vomiting also there. Continue diarrhea and vomiting occurs. Traveling to affected areas and eating shellfish. So when we are traveling from one place to the another place, definitely when we are eating different things from different areas and different types of waters if you are taking, and due to which we are changing into our eating habits. When you are eating this shellfish, undercooked shellfish, definitely it will produce the diarrheal conditions. And no distinguishing clinical manifestation for cholera. Here the differential diagnosis, for example, enterotoxigenic, for example, E. coli, and bacterial food poisoning, sometimes bacterial food poisoning can be developed, and the viral gastroenteritis. So these are the various diagnostic tools by which we can easily diagnose the symptoms of cholera. Diagnosis. So for diagnosis, we should take the sample of stool culture and we should watch under the microscope and confirm presence of cholera toxins, and we should confirm that whether it is cholera toxins or not. Cholera rapid test dipsticks are there. So cholera rapid test, by taking that sample, stool sample, we should do the rapid test and we should identify whether it is cholera or not. Other lab findings: dehydration leads to high blood urea and serum creatinine. So due to the dehydration, it leads into the high blood urea and serum creatinine, because these both the quantities has been increased. Hemocrits and WBC will also be high due to the hemo concentration, because our WBC and RBC, these hemocrits means RBC, they are remain as it is in numbers, but the water, the plasma level has been declined due to the loss of water, due to which the hemo concentration is going to be increased. The viscosity of your RBC WBC has been increased, and it will develop the condition like polycythemia, means high numbers of all the blood cells, but the viscosity has been increased. Dehydration and bicarbonate loss in stool leads to metabolic acidosis with anion gap. Total body potassium is depleted because all the potassium is going to be come out from the body. It has been expelled. It has been secreted outside, due to which the hypokalemic condition can be developed. But serum level may be normal due to the effect of acidosis. Treatment. Their treatment can be done by two ways. One, by rehydration. So whatever dehydration has been occurred, so we should produce the condition like rehydration, means the electrolyte which has been thrown outside, which has been released outside, so that can be recaptured, regained. So by oral or by intravenous way, either you should give the intravenous way of saline, so by giving infusion, or by oral rehydration salt, you should give the ORS to the patients. And second is by antimicrobial therapy. So whatever the cause of your disease there, so that cause you have to nullify, you have to clarify. So this is the WHO guideline which has been determined by the WHO for the management of cholera. So there are various steps in treatment of patient with suspected cholera as follows. Now this is the first stage. Assess for dehydration. So we should check with how much dehydration has been occurred. Dehydration occurs or not, how much dehydration occurs, that you should check, assess. Rehydrate the patients and monitor frequently, then reassess hydration status. So due to the diarrhea and due to this omitting, lots of electrolytes has been lost. So we should regain that electrolytes. So by giving the ORS, oral rehydration salt, by giving that, you should try to maintain that electrolytes into your body, and you should monitor, means after each hour you should give that ORS to the patient to maintain and to monitor their hydration status. Maintain hydration. So you should maintain the hydration constantly. You should give that water, give that ORS to the patient, and you should maintain that hydration. Replace ongoing fluid losses until diarrhea stops. So continuously we should replace that fluid which is going outside from the body. So immediately you should give the fluid from external resources like ORS or like fruit juice or any sort of water which contains electrolytes or saline water. So by saline infusion also you should give continuously to the patients until the diarrhea has been stopped. Administer the oral antibiotic to the patients with severe dehydration. So identify the antibiotic which is suitable for the patients and you should continue the therapy. Feed the patients and also try to feed the patient the food which is easily digestible, so they can digest easily and they can give the energy to the patient. That food you should give to the patients. More detailed guidelines for the treatment of cholera are as follows. Evaluate the degree of dehydration upon arrival. So you should evaluate how much degree of dehydration has been occurred, how much the severity of patient is there, and rehydrate the patient in two phases. This includes rehydration for 2 to 4 hours and maintenance until the diarrhea abates. So we should maintain the rehydration until the process of diarrhea has been stopped and maintain that. Register output and intake volume of pre-designed chart and periodically review this data. So we should register how much vomiting has been occurred, how much volume of vomiting or stools going outside. So that you should maintain the register, how much quantity is going outside and how much quantity we are taking inside. So you should register, you should maintain that data. Use the intravenous route only during the rehydration phase for severely dehydrated patients for whom an infusion rate is 50 to 100 ml per kg per hour is advised. So the condition, if it is very severe, the patient is not able to eat, not able to drink, very unresponsive condition is there, in that condition we should give them intravenously. So whatever electrolytes are there, whatever the dextrose is there, that dextrose and electrolytes we should give intravenously to regain the energy, to regain the conditions. So at which rate 50 to 100 ml per kg per hour. So at this rate you should give the electrolytes or dextrose or glucose to the patients constantly. For moderately dehydrated patients who do not tolerate the oral route and during the maintenance phase, in patient considered high stool purgers, that is 10 ml per kg per hour. So in that condition we should give them infusion. During the maintenance phase, use oral rehydration solution at the rate of 800 to 1000 ml per hour. Match outgoing losses and ORS administration. Now if patient is able to drink something or able to eat something, in that condition we should try to maintain the phase. So how will maintain that phase? By giving the ORS, oral rehydration salt, you should give to the patient. At which rate? At the rate of 800 to 1000 ml per hour, means in 1 hour you should give 1 liter of ORS solutions. And we should match with the ongoing losses. So whatever water has been lost or electrolyte has been lost, so accordingly we should give the quantity of ORS. So means you should match that quantity. If loss is more, you should give the more ORS, more water to the patients. If it is less, So accordingly, we should give that quantity of ORA solution to the patients. Discharge patient to the treatment center, if discharge patient to the treatment center, if oral tolerance is greater than or equal to the 1000 ml per hour, urine volume is greater than or equal to the 40 ml per hour, or stool volume is less than equal to the 400 ml to per hour. So discharge the patients, when you will discharge, when the treatment is going to be over or almost over. And if these are the various borderlines, or these are the taglines, if they are equal to these quantities, the stool volume is equal to 40 ml per hour and stool volume is less than equal to 400 ml per hour. So if urine volume is 40 ml and the stool volume is 400 ml or less than that, so then and then we should discharge the patient. Otherwise we should not discharge the patients. So these all are nothing but the guidelines by WHO for management of this cholera. So this chart is very, very important. Try to recall all these specific guidelines. Now, assessment of patients with diarrhea for dehydration based on WHO classification. So in that, the various types are there: the clinical features, none, some dehydration and severe dehydration. So it can be categorized into three parts. They are the predicted degree of dehydration, how much dehydration has been occurred. So we should categorize these patients according to their symptoms, their severity. Now, general appearance. So if they are none, so in the less than 5% is there, so they are well and alert. So some dehydration, 5 to 10%, so they are restless and irritable. And in severe dehydrations, which are less than or more than 10%, so in that condition they are abnormally sleepy or lethargic, means patient becomes very sleepy. They will try to sleep again and again, and they will show the condition like lethargy, means they are less responsive, they are not having too much power, too much capacity to stand or to sit as well. So they becomes very, very unresponsive, they becomes very, very weak. So it is called lethargy. Eyes, so in none it is normal, in some dehydration it is sunken, and severe dehydration they will sunken. As we have already discovered, is sunken means eyes are going too much deep, too much down, they becomes very pale, they will protrude outside, and the skin below the eye becomes very dark, very black, and skin becomes very, very, very dry, and they are inflamed also. The skin around the eye will become inflamed, and they will completely without tears, means it is dry, that's why tears won't come outside. Now, according to thirst, so in less than 5%, it is drink normally, not thirsty. In some dehydration, they are thirsty, drink eagerly, and in severe condition, they drink poorly or unable to drink because they don't have any capacity, any power to drink the water. Skin pinch goes back quickly because if you pinch, immediately it will go back that skin. And in some dehydration, go back slowly, means within 2 seconds it will go back. And in this condition, in severe condition, it requires more than 2 seconds to go back. It will require more than 2 seconds, it will require 5 seconds or 10 seconds also. Estimated fluid deficit, so here it is less than 50 ml per kg. So here it is 50 to 100 ml per kg, and severe it is more than 100 ml per kg. So by this we can categorize the patients which are having less severe, means moderate, mild, moderate and severe. Now next, decision. So how can we take decision? Patient has no dehydration. And here, if the patient has two or more signs, some dehydration is present. And if patient has two or more these signs, severe dehydration is present. So in this fashion, we can categorize, we can identify what is the importance here. We should able to identify according to their symptoms, according to their manifestations, their category. We should immediately classify the patients, and accordingly we should give them treatment. We should try to control these conditions. What is our main aim? Our main aim is to control this condition, control the cholera, and to do its management. Treatment of cholera. Rehydration is accomplished in two phases, either by rehydration or maintenance. So by this two way we should control these patients. Now treatment of cholera. So one by rehydration. The goal of rehydration phase is to restore the normal hydration status. Means before the infection, how was the patient? So we should maintain at the normal status. We should take more than 4 hours. In some condition it will take more than 4 hours, in some condition within 4 hours also it is possible. Set the rate of intravenous infusion in severely hydrated patients at 50 to 100 ml per kg per hour. So we should maintain the infusion at this level. Lactated Ringer solution is preferred over isotonic sodium chloride solutions, because saline does not correct the metabolic acidosis. So that's why we should go for the lactated Ringer solution. This is the major element that we should concentrate here. Now next, at maintenance. The goal of maintenance phase is to maintain the normal hydration status by replacing ongoing losses. So according to the ongoing losses, whatever the water or fluid has been lost in vomiting as well as in feces, according to that quantity we should replace by the maintenance dose. Means that much quantity of infusion or that much quantity of ORS we should give. The oral route is preferred, and use of oral rehydration salt or solution ORS at the rate of 500 to 1000 ml per hour is recommended. That depends on the severity of the patients. The fluid should never be restricted. Means whatever fluid that you can give, you can give, you should give, because this is the major thing by which without drugs also you can control the condition of cholera. If patient is having somewhat power in his body, so he can regenerate that condition, he can withstand with that condition, and he can fight with that conditions, because immunity can be developed if you are having power in your body. Now these are the signs of dehydrations. When we are having signs of dehydrations, so two or more following signs: this sunken eyes, absence of tears, dry mouth and tongue,